friends, today we are on the journey, 45th session. 44 sessions already over, 45th session. We got yet another wonderful speaker, Justice Gopinath. He'll be dealing with the subject, should public law remedies be discretionary? Today, we have the privilege of having Justice Ramkumar, Justice Chidambaresh, Justice Jayashankar Nambiar, Justice Abraham Mathew, sir, and the entire lot of persons, the participants who have been with us for the last 44 sessions. Today also, the journey continues in the discovery of nuances of law. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sam. Respected former judges of the High Court of Kerala, my respected brother in all respects, Justice Jayashankar Nambiar, respected members of the legal fraternity, my dear friends, ladies, you'll see me looking at the other screen just to look at my notes. So maybe I may not be looking at the camera or the entirety of the time. Good afternoon to all of you. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. I asked Mrs. Champatman this morning as to whether there was any protocol regarding the time for which I was expected to speak. He said 1 hour. I don't think I'll keep you that long on a Sunday afternoon. Sam said, this topic is about should public law remedies be discretionary? I will start the lecture with something that my professor told once when he was dealing with the subject of anti-suit injunctions. He started it this way. He said there was a tribunal in France which was constituted after the French Revolution. It was called the Revolutionary Tribunal, a very good name, I think, it was given to it at that point of time. And people accused political crimes were called upon to state their case before the tribunal. So whatever they said, and however well they acquitted themselves, the tribunal would decree that they be executed or guillotined at the end of the process. So my attempt to speak to this enlightened audience has put me in a position of a person summoned to appear before that revolutionary tribunal. My views are likely to be torn to pieces, but I hope I won't be executed.
Unfortunately, we have no guillotine.
Rather than a lecture, I would like this to be an interactive session. I would request all of you to interrupt me with your thoughts whenever necessary. And I hope that we will we can have a fruitful discussion at the end of the session. I must confess that even the title of today's topic is stolen from a lecture by Lord Justice Bingham to the Administrative Law Bar Association on October 17, 1990. The title of this lecture must appropriately be changed as something which suggests that this is more of a discussion on the views expressed by that great judge in his lecture, should public law remedies be discretionary, or even more appropriately as my attempt to bring to your attention the views expressed therein. Those of you who would be interested, that lecture, text of that lecture is available in the journal Public Law at 1991 PL64. Lord Bingham starts his lecture in a fairly unique fashion. He asks his audience, what would we do if we were stopped on the street by an intellectually curious Martian and questioned, what do you mean by rule of law? He says that though our answer to that question may be more or less incoherent, we would or should possibly proclaim and state that an important element of this principle is that we are governed by a set of rules which are clear and publicly stated and does not depend, to use his own words, on the whims, prejudices, or predilections of the individual decision maker. Now, all of us who have practiced law in the writ courts would have possibly come across a statement in some judgments, sometimes more expressed in court rather than in judgments. But I am not inclined to interfere with this in exercise of my discretionary jurisdiction. Now, discretionary jurisdiction under Article 226 of the Constitution of India. Now, the question that is posed here is whether this exercise is sound in law. Should relief be declined because the individual judge is not inclined to exercise his jurisdiction, though there exists sufficient grounds to interfere? Is it not necessary to have at least a broad set of grounds on which such discretion should be exercised? These are the questions for which we will attempt to find some answer today. The issue that we are discussing today really boils down to this. Can a litigant seeking a remedy under public law be denied relief even if he shows that he is entitled to it? Was such discretion envisaged by the constitution makers? Now, recently, the Specific Relief Act has been amended in 2018, if I'm not mistaken, which practically, even in cases of suits filed for specific relief, the discretion vested in the judge has been whittled down substantially. Am I right, Prem?
Yesterday, we did have an in-depth analysis of this by Justice Sunil Thomas because we dealt with this subject. So the entire participants are conscious and they would like to have, they might even put some questions regarding that today.
Yes. I wanted to draw the attention of the audience to the provisions of the Specific Relief Act because I believe those amendments were brought in as a part of ease of doing business where I think the lawmakers felt that we must have a little more certainty in the in persons who might enter into contractual relationship being faced with a situation where the other side does not really comply with its obligations under the contract. And on going to court, ultimately, the court saying, look here, I am not going to specifically enforce the terms of the contract. You will be sufficiently compensated by award of damages or compensation, whatever word that you want to put to it. So when these provisions relating to essentially in the private law field have been amended, what is it that we must do in the public law sphere? This is still a question that begs an answer for the simple reason that we have not, I don't think, yet determined the rules by which we would decline relief. Now, here I think the basic difference between English administrative or judicial review in England and judicial review under our constitution is this. Judicial review, as far as the courts in England are concerned, are dealt with under the rules of the Supreme Court, which I believe I still call the rules of the Supreme Court, where there are specific rules dealing with judicial review, applications for judicial review. There is a strict time limit for applying for judicial review. I think it is 6 months. And the courts generally do not extend that time limit unless circumstances really warrant it. As far as we are concerned, we don't really enforce any time limit per se insofar as repetitions are concerned. But we do, of course, look at the question as to whether there is substantial delay in approaching the court. The substantial difference between the rules relating to judicial review in the United Kingdom and in our courts is this. Our power of judicial review is essentially traced to Article 32 and 226 of the Constitution. We have not laid down any procedural rule except from the High Court rules, etc., which deal purely with procedure relating to filing, etc. We have not so far made any procedural law relating to exercise of judicial review. Now, the UK courts also, UK rules also require leave to apply for judicial review. Now, the very basis of Lord Justice Bingham's lecture is to establish that discretion to grant or refuse relief cannot, even in the public law sphere, be exercised except on very well settled grounds. Now, before we go to the article itself, I think it is necessary for us to look at the decision in O'Reilly versus Mackman. Now, this is a case where certain prisoners of Hull Prison, if I remember right, applied for setting aside certain disciplinary recommendations made against them by the visitors of Hull Prison, which resulted in them being denied parole, etc. Now, some of them applied to set aside that decision. They were complaining of a procedural problem in the decision making. Now, they were saying some of them applied for judicial review under Order 53 of their rules of the Supreme Court. Some of them filed motion under private law. So essentially, when this matter reached the House of Lords, Lord Diplock took the view that where there is a remedy under public law, that is a remedy by way of judicial review, it would be an abuse of process of court to allow somebody to apply for relief under private law. Now, why I think this decision is important is this. Because Lord Diplock in that decision says that it would be an abuse of process of law to allow somebody to apply for private law relief because the protections, he calls that the protections that are available in public law insofar as the public authority is concerned. Now, this is where I think this becomes interesting, because the decision, Lord Diplock says that if one were to adopt the private law remedies when the remedy of judicial review was available, the public authority would lose what he calls safeguards imposed in public interest against groundless, unmeritorious, or tardy attacks upon the validity of decisions made by public authorities in the field of public law. Now, is this a reason? This is a thought that has always occurred to me. Is this the ground on which we have always thought, or we have always held, that remedies in public law are always discretionary and the court can, even in a case where something is a person proves his entitlement to relief, we would refrain from granting relief on the principle that ultimately we are dealing with the decision of a public authority. Now, if this were the case, this were the reason why we would have discretion in public law or in granting reliefs under public law, then should it not then be necessary for us to set out the rules, the clear rules on the basis of which we would say that if these situations arise, we will not grant relief. But in any other situation, the litigant would be entitled to relief. This, I think, is the central theme of today's discussion. Now, Lord Justice Bingham gives or lists out 9 grounds on which relief may be refused in judicial review proceedings. But I think before we proceed to discuss those grounds or look at those grounds very briefly, I think there is a difference in the language employed in Articles 32 and 226. And very briefly, we must also look at the prerogative writs mentioned therein and the definition of discretion which Lord Bingham gives in his article. Now, Article 32.2 of the Constitution of India says, the Supreme Court shall have power to issue directions or orders or writs, including writs in the nature of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, quo warranto, and certiorari, whichever may be appropriate for the enforcement of any of the rights conferred by this part. Similarly, 226.1 also uses the words writs in the nature of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition, quo warranto, and certiorari. Now, is there any significance in the words employed in articles 32 and 226. I would believe so, because in my view, the constitution makers did not intend to import into Indian constitutional law the technicalities of the prerogative writs which were practiced in England. So therefore, the question again arises, if the technicalities of the rules relating to those prerogative writs as in England are not available in India, would the courts in India, the High Court and the Supreme Court, of course, still retain any authority to refuse relief in exercise of discretion? If those now writs, the prerogative writs by their very nature, some of them except possibly in the case of in the case of habeas corpus, which issues ex debito justiciae, all other writs are essentially discretionary. Now, if those principles have not been incorporated or imported into Indian constitutional law, on what basis would Indian courts say that we will not grant relief just because we feel that in our discretion, we need not grant relief in excess of our discretion? Now, most of the prerogative writs which are mentioned in both Article 32 and Article 226, habeas corpus, of course, I just mentioned, if a case is proved of illegal detention, it issues ex debito justiciae. I don't think it has ever been suggested that a court in India would retain discretion to refuse relief even in a case where a habeas corpus is sought for if the case is proved. Now, certiorari has always been regarded as discretionary. Now, as early as in 1961, a constitution bench of our court, but certiorari, often we are faced with situations where the courts would say that if you have an effective alternate remedy, we will not issue a certiorari, even if it is shown that the authority was acting without jurisdiction. Now, as early as in 1961, a constitution bench of our Supreme Court in Calcutta Discount Company versus Income Tax Officer said that the high courts have ample powers under Article 226 of the Constitution and are in duty bound thereunder to issue such appropriate orders and directions as are necessary in order to prevent persons from being subject to lengthy proceedings and unnecessary harassment by an executive authority acting without jurisdiction. Alternate remedies such as are provided by the Income Tax Act cannot always be a sufficient reason for refusing quick relief in a fit and proper case. Now, Wade and Forsyth also seems to take the same view when they opine, if an applicant can show illegality, it is wrong in principle to require him to exercise a right of appeal. Illegal action should be stopped in its tracks as soon as it is shown. Sadly, they take this view in the 1994 edition. They make no reference to Calcutta Discount Company versus Income Tax Officer. Now, prohibition ordinarily granted ex debito justiciae to prevent a defect of jurisdiction, but could be refused on grounds of delay, failure to take up objection as to jurisdiction, acquiescence or waiver. So whether any of these grounds would cloak the court or tribunal acting in excess of jurisdiction with jurisdiction is at the very least debatable. Mandamus and quo warranto have always been considered discretionary. Now, Lord Justice Bingham gives nine grounds, as I said before, on which discretion in public law could be refused in excess of discretion under public law. But he gives a very beautiful description of what he means by judicial discretion. Now, I will read that. I will be permitted to read that. Now, this is what he says. Before answering that question, I should make clear what I mean by judicial discretion. I hope that I may be permitted to repeat. I'll skip that portion. He says, an issue falls within a judge's discretion if, being governed by no rule of law, its resolution depends on the individual judge's assessment within such boundaries as have been laid down of what is fair and just to do in the particular case. He has no discretion in making his findings of fact. He has no discretion in his findings on the law. But when, having made any necessary finding of fact and any necessary ruling of law, he has to choose between different courses of action, orders, penalties, or remedies, he then exercises a discretion. It is only when he reaches the stage of asking himself, what is the fair and just thing to do or order in the instant case, that he embarks, on the exercise of a discretion. Now, therefore, does this mean that before the courts exercise, decide that they will either interfere or not interfere in exercise of discretion, they have to necessarily reach or conclude upon their findings of fact and their findings of law?
It's okay.
Distraction.
It's okay.
Yeah. So is it that a judge has to necessarily render findings of fact, findings of law, and then embark on the exercise of his discretion to say that I will not grant relief for reasons A, B, C, D, E, F? Or is it that he should, in the first instance, say that Justice Chidambaram is obviously speaking on the phone with somebody.
Yeah, that I saw. I just muted him for the time being. He'll be back.
Yeah. So this definition of discretion had me thinking: is it necessary for a judge before he exercises or embarks on the relief to be granted? Is it at that stage alone that he enters the realm of exercise of discretion? Or does he have to exercise it at the first stage? Suppose a case comes up and really speaking, it's a case where there's a clear alternate remedy. There's no reason. There's not even a suggestion that the original authority had decided the matter without jurisdiction. But it's a case on merits. Why should the judge enter into controversies regarding the merits of the case? He can simply say that I don't exercise my discretion to grant relief because there is an effective alternate remedy. But this definition of discretion of Lord Justice Bingham suggests that it is only at the end stage, after having rendered findings of fact and having rendered findings on the law applicable to the case, would the judge reach the stage of saying whether he will exercise his discretion in one way or the other. I think in the Indian context, I had a discussion with Justice Nambiar also on this thought, and I think we agreed with each other that this is not possibly practical in the Indian context, where every case we would reach a conclusion on the law applicable on the facts of the case. We find the facts in one way or the other and then find the law in one way or the other before we say that we will either exercise discretion or not exercise discretion. So I think this definition of discretion may not really apply in our situation. Now, coming to the grounds, this is what he says. He says that there are 9 grounds on which he thinks discretion can possibly be exercised to refuse relief even when a case is proved. Now, the first ground which he says is delay. Now, delay is a ground which I think our courts also often look at to see whether any relief should be granted or not. A classic example or a straightforward example of delay defeating rights would be in the case of service matters, when there is a seniority issue to be resolved and people actually don't challenge the seniority position which have been settled for quite a long time. We have a large number of decisions which say in such situations the courts need not grant relief, even if one of the employees were to establish a case that he's entitled to a better seniority position in the list, because that would be unsettling something that is settled for a long period of time. So delay certainly is one of the grounds on which on which I think courts can refuse relief in public law proceedings. The second ground is the ground relating to standing. Now, unless
the task of removing that's happened.
Now, unless one were to have the right to ask for a particular relief, certainly the courts can look at the status of the parties before it. Again, to take an example from service law, standing, it has been consistently held that there is no public interest in service matters, except possibly in a writ of quo warranto, where public are genuinely interested to see that an office is held by a person who has the qualifications to hold it. So standing certainly is one of the grounds on which a relief can be refused by courts exercising judicial review. Now, third is fairly interesting, because he says acquiescence is also a ground on which relief could be refused. In fact, his article, if you read it, he says that even in a case where a prohibition is sought for, there are instances where acquiescence has been held to be fatal to an application for a writ of prohibition. Now, this is where I think I have some doubt, because can jurisdiction be conferred by consent? I think our courts have already held that there can't be any jurisdiction conferred by consent. So acquiescence by itself, or subjecting oneself to the jurisdiction of a court or a tribunal where it does not have any such jurisdiction, can't be a ground to refuse relief when a ground is taken that the court or tribunal had no jurisdiction to decide upon the matter in issue. So I think acquiescence may be in some circumstances a ground to refuse relief, but not. I don't think that acquiescence will readily be available as a ground to refuse relief in such matters. Now, fourth, which is possibly very relevant in our context, in the context of litigation as we see it in India, conduct and motives of the applicant. Now, it would not be appropriate for me as a judge to expand too much on this, but I can say that experience as a lawyer has shown that very often this cases which are categorized as public interest litigations are actually proceedings intended to do something else than to protect public interest, leading the Supreme Court to refer to PIL as either paisa interest litigation or publicity interest litigation or politics interest litigation. So I will leave it at that, but conduct and motives of the applicant in a proceeding for seeking judicial review of a particular action or whatever is certainly a ground on which relief can be refused by the courts. Now, exhaustion of other remedies, we have already seen how it was dealt with in the case of, we have already discussed Calcutta discount and the opinion of Wade, that where jurisdiction is completely lacking, even exhaustion of other remedies is not really a bar to exercise of certiorari jurisdiction. Now, two grounds which he has mentioned as ground number 6 and 7, sometimes I think there is an overlap, because inevitability of outcome. Now, there was a case, I think, which was decided by Lord Justice Bingham himself, which he refers to in the article. It was a case of, I think it is called R versus Thames Valley Police Ex Parte Cotton. That was a case where a police officer was overweight. He was required under the regulations to be of a certain weight, commensurate, I think, with his height. So he was consistently overweight. Now, he was dismissed without inquiry. Now, the question was whether the writ court or a court faced with this with an application for judicial review of the proceedings should have interfered with the decision, because it was an admitted fact that he was above, his weight was above what was fixed by the regulation. So while refusing relief, I think Lord Justice Bingham has basically listed out the very same 9 items where relief could be refused in exercise of discretion. So that, I think, is a clear-cut case. Suppose the police regulations require the officer to be below a certain weight and also provides for removal from service if he exceeds that weight consistently for a period of time. Now, if that case were to come on the ground that there was no inquiry held or is in breach of violations of principles of or in breach of principles of natural justice, why would the courts interfere? So this and the next ground, which is no useful purpose would be served, are grounds which essentially require the court to look at the merits and determine whether the courts would naturally, in a case like this, determine that there was a breach of the rules of principles of natural justice if an officer were to be dismissed for without holding an inquiry. But then, would it then issue a writ? What would be the effect of issuing a writ? The effect would be that the inquiry would be held, and ultimately, the officer will have at the end of the inquiry, the officer will have to be dismissed because he was at the relevant point of time above in breach of the regulations. So I think 6 and 7, inevitability of outcome and no useful purpose being served are certainly grounds on which the courts exercising powers of judicial review can keep in mind when refusing relief. Item number 8 is very interesting. Adverse public consequences. Now, should courts look at the consequences of grant of relief and look at the possibility of, let us say, a highly political case were to come up before the court and the decision of the court in that case would have the effect of toppling the government. To say that some case of such nature comes up before the court. Should the court look at the possibility of adverse public consequences and decide that it will not grant relief, even though grounds have been made out for grant of relief? I would think no. I mean, that's my humble opinion. But adverse public consequences can never be a ground, I think, for courts to refuse grant of relief. The last ground which Lord Justice Bingham has mentioned is restricted areas. Of course, in the Indian context also, courts have always held that in certain areas, such as, for example, foreign policy, relations with other nations, and generally matters of government policy are strict no-no for the courts. So, act of declaring war, withdrawing from war, withdrawing from a treaty, friendly relations with other countries, these are really areas where the courts have no expertise and no basis, no authority really to determine the issue one way or the other. So restricted area certainly is a ground which can be available for exercise of discretion. Now, I was thinking hard from the morning in the context of the in the Indian context whether there were any further grounds that would be added to his list of 9. I really did not see anything. I think this is fairly an exhaustive list, and I would therefore conclude by saying that I completely endorse the view of Lord Justice Bingham in his article and say that even in public law we must have some certainty. We can't simply say this just because I don't like the face of the litigant, I don't like the face of the lawyer possibly. I wouldn't say that, but then that's just for the sake of it. I would refuse. I can't simply say, I can't sit on the chair and simply say, I know you have a case, but I don't feel I should grant you relief. So this is essentially the thought that I wanted to put across today, that today when in private law we have amended the Specific Relief Act, we have reduced the discretion of courts. So public law is an equally important element in the whole galaxy of litigation, possibly even more important than adjudication of private law rights. So therefore, I think it is time that the courts evolved a system or a uniform system, I must say, because ultimately judicial review is, I have heard judges of great repute say that any case coming can be decided both ways. It can be decided for the petitioner, it can be decided for the respondent. So this is essentially where the question of discretion comes up. I think it is time for us, especially because we don't have a procedural code governing judicial review, to evolve a uniform set of rules by which we would say that if such circumstances exist, we will not grant relief. It is difficult to possibly enumerate every circumstance, but broadly, I think these grounds which we have discussed today should form the basis on which the courts must, courts exercising powers of judicial review must exercise their discretion whether or not to grant relief. I think, as I said, I don't think I've kept you long, and I think this is what I had to say. I'll leave the floor open for discussions.
Sir, what else can we say? Very bold and very daring statements that has come from you, sir. Subjective or objective justice, number one. Number two, when party autonomy is being recognized and appreciated in the private law sector, why not in public law or public law remedies domain? Why it shouldn't be? Should it be left to something which is very, very uncertain as discretionary or otherwise? We leave the floor open. We'll start with the comments of the expert panel. Ramkumar, sir, over to you.
Oh, I am, in my case, this is a jurisdiction which I never virtually exercise. Anyway, crisp exposition of the principles with clarity. Can there be an additional ground? I don't know. That the respondent not being amenable to the writ jurisdiction. Could it be, or is it already covered by the grounds already mentioned? I don't know. I'm not very sure. The respondent is of such a nature, or such a person that he is not amenable to the writ jurisdiction.
Certainly, sir. And I think that's also a ground definitely the courts can look at. But I think that
that would be that a very preliminary ground. Justice Gopi, if you would just permit me, sir, then the discretionary relief itself may not be exercised because you are not amenable for jurisdiction.
Yes, but that is discovered only later.
Correct, sir. Correct.
Not at the threshold. I think
all those earlier decisions of the Supreme Court, which kept apart commercial activities of the state from outside the scope of judicial review, etc., on the ground that those are really commercial activities which possibly the government is free to enter into just like any other individual. Now that all those principles have been watered out, so today we will look possibly at just the body and determine whether it's an odd body answering to the definition of our state under Article 12. So of course, we have expanded it.
Yes, even torts we have made it to constitutional torts.
Yes.
In fact, can I just chip in?
Definitely. You are the best person.
This is Ramkumar. Just to answer your question, I think. Yes. Probably the most succinct and easy test for Article 226 jurisdiction, exercise of jurisdiction under Article 226 was laid down by Justice Nambooripad ages ago.
NDP Nambooripad, yes.
NDP Nambooripad, Justice Baldassan father.
Father.
And, he said it in his own way. He said, we have something called the Panchavyuha. And the Panchavyuha translates into nothing more than this, that you first look at who the petitioner is in a writ petition. You have to see whether he satisfies the tests of a person who can maintain a litigation. In other words, is he of sound mind? Is he a minor, etc., etc.?
Person aggrieved, not that.
All
not
the that. Incapacities for suing.
Okay.
That's the first test. You then go to see whether the respondent is a person against whom a public law, a writ or a public law remedy would lie. So that will answer your question as to whether he comes within the definition of state, whether...
See, even against a private person, writ is now maintainable in certain...
Maintainable only when he is discharging a public function.
Exactly. So,
there is one more ground which is worthy of exploring for those who are inclined constitutionally. Under our constitution, we have a concept of fundamental rights which are guaranteed by the state. So the citizens' protection of fundamental rights is always vis-a-vis the state. However, under our constitution, we also have three articles, which are Article 15, 2, 17, and 23, I think, the one against conscription. These three articles are basically guarantees of fundamental rights, even vis-a-vis other citizens, fellow citizens. Yeah. Now, if there is a guarantee of a fundamental right vis-a-vis a fellow citizen, the question may automatically arise as to whether if a fellow citizen breaches your right or does not recognize your right, can you approach a writ court, which you are entitled to do under Article 32, to the Supreme Court itself, and failing that, 226 in the High Court? Can you not proceed against the a fellow citizen who has breached your fundamental right?
Even in habeas corpus, we are doing that.
Habeas corpus is different because it is a personal liberty thing.
Right.
Other writs, for example, if you go to Article 15.2, which prevents prohibition or discrimination in places of public worship, or hotels, etc., public places. Suppose you were to get into a theater or any other public place and you're refused entry there for some arbitrary reason. Can you say that, can you approach a high court and say that there is a breach of my right, a fundamental right, by a fellow citizen? So there you're filing a writ petition against a fellow citizen.
So public transport.
Exactly. So
where Gandhiji was refused.
These are areas that we need to explore. And I know I'm treading dangerous ground here because, the first thing tomorrow morning could be 15 writ petitions on this ground. but coming back to the Nambooripad's Panchavyuha, after the respondents, the third would be, the question as to whether this respondent would be a state under Article 12, because the same argument, public duty or... state for purposes of Article 12 or public duty for 226. Fourth is the alternate remedy. Is there an effective alternate remedy? In which case, prudence demands more than anything else that the person be relegated to the alternate remedy. Last would be laches, and which is if you are approaching a court with unreasonable delay, and therefore that would be the fifth one. And I'm told, I've not been fortunate to appear before Justice Nambooripad, but I'm told that he adhered to these principles steadfastly throughout his career at the bench. Now, Gobi, if I could just say two things about what you mentioned in about this Justice Bingham's discretion. In India, the reason why we... it's not as though we are averse to exercising discretion in public law matters. But unlike Britain, which doesn't have a written constitution, in our country, we have a written constitution and every administrative action is tested not only against the statute under which that authority functions, but also against the constitution. And when we have developed our concepts under the constitution, such as arbitrariness, Article 14. Then you go to Article 21, right to life. Right to life now encompasses almost everything under the sun. So when you've gone and expanded the horizons of these concepts under our constitution, then any action can easily be molded as ultra vires the constitution and therefore avail a public law remedy. And the difficulty with that is a person may come before the court and he or she may say that there is a breach of the public, a breach of the law and a breach of my rights under the constitution. And therefore I must come before the court. But we are forgetting that unlike in Britain, there cannot be a final adjudication on facts. You may be convinced of the law and you may be convinced of the need to give him a relief, assuming that these are facts which are established. But there lies the question, because invariably in these writ petitions, you do not get to decide on the facts. And even in cases where persons have, take for example, the tax cases, and I know there are many tax lawyers here who have suffered in my instance. When persons come challenging maybe an assessment order or at the stage when they are before the authority, and then they come before this court, it is not as though we don't understand that the law is this, and if these are the facts, then he should succeed. But we deny him the relief because we are not sure whether these are the facts. And a final determination of facts has to happen at the lower levels, no matter how good or bad the assessing officer or the appellate authority is. So it is for ensuring a finality of the facts and then applying the law to the finalized facts that we relegate them to the alternate remedy. That's one reason. The second, of course, is the peculiar problem with India and its litigation. The volumes are unmanageable. And therefore, unlike Britain and the House of Lords, which does about 243 cases in a year, we get through that number in one bench of the Supreme Court in a day. So the volumes are sizable. And if the high courts are going to be crowded with writ petitions on public law remedies without going to the civil remedies in the competent civil courts, then we are heading for disaster. It is not as though, and this is the last point I want to make, it's not as though we are not exercising discretion. We are abstaining from exercising discretion in cases which clearly have no legs to stand. For example, an absolute lack of jurisdiction. We have our decisions on that. Whirlpool, Calcutta Discount, Popcorn Entertainments, all those decisions are there which say that if it is patently without jurisdiction, the High Court, you come to the High Court and we straight away set aside the show cause notice or proposal. The bifurcation which you were talking about and which Lord Diplock also mentioned, in the grounds also which they stated, the bifurcation of admission stage and relief stage. Admission stage, the discretion is denied or discretion is exercised to deny relief only in these circumstances. The relief, as you rightly said, we do the same thing when we entertain a writ petition. Or even when entertaining a writ petition, we may be convinced that this is a matter where there has been a violation of natural justice and therefore the whole proceedings must go. But at the same time, you will recall that Justice Jagannathan Rao had coined this phrase of useless formalities. And that basically says nothing more than this, that even if there is a violation of natural justice, if eventually you are not going to succeed anyway, then why use the violation of natural justice to set aside your case? I mean, the lawyer may be happy, the client may be happy for getting through one round, but you're never going to get beyond that. So, wherever there is a useless formality is not probably the most eloquently worded phrase, but what it translates into is that it will be meaningless and it will be a futile exercise to issue a writ where ultimately the client litigant is not going to succeed.
So, probably that post-additional opportunity. Yes. Arose out of that.
Correct.
And additional opportunity.
It is not like the case which Gopi described, that fat policeman. Now, if he has been consistently overweight for a given period of time and the rules prescribe that you have to be within that thing, within that period, no matter what you're going to do, you're still not going to get back into shape for the past period. And the damage is already done. So merely because of a procedural violation, you cannot set aside, because ultimately you cannot get an order of reinstatement because it is already gone. So in those circumstances, even in India, we do deny relief. We say it's futile. Issuance of a writ is futile, therefore we don't exercise. Just
Jayashankar, kindly repeat NDP Namboori Pat's test.
Panchavyuha.
That is, first is about the petitioner.
First is about the petitioner. The second is about the respondent.
Nah.
The third is about the maintainability.
Okay.
In the sense as to what is, whether the ingredients of a writ petition and under 226 are satisfied, whether there is any right violated, whether the fundamental right violated, and whether the authority is a state or a public authority. Fourth is there an effective alternate remedy? And the fifth is it hit by laches?
Thank you.
Hey, I think I thought the most interesting aspect of today, I mean, I wanted to have more interaction on this, is Lord Diplock's finding in O'Reilly versus Mackman. Now, it would be surprising for us in our courts. We have often heard judges saying that there are disputed questions of fact involved, and therefore you better go and file a suit. Now, even if a remedy of judicial review, now going by Justice Namboori Pat's, 5-point test, Panchavyuha, however he has put it. Now, even if you were to cross that, now if you go by Lord Diplock's finding in O'Reilly versus Mackman, he would say the opposite. He would say that because in private law, you are entitled to certain reliefs on your proving your case. In public law, the courts still retain a discretion not to grant relief. Mm. And therefore, since the rules of public law are designed to protect public authorities from unnecessary attacks on their decisions, this is exactly what he says.
Right.
He says, it would be an abuse of process of law to actually approach and exercise your private law, private situation which, we would not think about in the High Court at all.
We have just inverted it.
We do the opposite. When judicial review is available, but still there are disputed questions of fact involved, or we say you go and file a suit.
Correct. No, that's precisely because of this. Because, you see, when you want a finality on facts, because we always assume facts.
Evidence. Because you'll have to take evidence. Which is very cumbersome.
This is the biggest bane in writ petitions, because everybody comes here with authority on facts. But the reality is that nobody knows whether that is the fact. And we often find in the course of hearing that there is a gray area, there is a complete black hole sometimes with regard to facts. And therefore, it's dangerous. And which is why, if you look at the necessity of pleadings in a writ petition, the pronouncements of the Supreme Court have been very categoric, saying that the pleadings in a writ petition has to be exhaustive, because you do not have the facility of
leading evidence.
There's no finality of the facts. So everything must be there, so that you look, if there are documents, the entire documents must clearly point to a settled position in facts. But we don't find that. Our writ petitions, most of them go no more than 4 or 5 pages.
Apology for...
Chidambaram, sir, your thoughts on that?
No, I find that even for enforcement of contract of personal service, writ petitions are entertained merely because the respondent is a state under Article 12. That is really disquieting.
It is disappointing, because it is a settled principle of law. You cannot enforce contracts of personal service, but that happens.
If it is for enforcement of public right, all right, we can understand. For contract of personal service, I find that many writ petitions are entertained.
Sir, but I think where a person would be a person is given protection under Article 311 or under statutory regulations governing the right of a service, for another sake, SDI, or a person who is governed by Industrial Disputes Act being an employee. It's only those, the rest of it that we can't really touch on the ground that it is a contract of personal service.
No, the other is possibly interference because of what we have now famously developed as a sympathy of jurisprudence, which I don't think has a place in public law, no matter what people may say. You don't get popular when you exercise, when you deny relief in such cases. But then it is a truism. You can't be applying the law based on sympathy because the relief is not yours to give. I mean, sympathy, judge does not dole out charity by issuing writs. He can sympathize with the cause, but he can do precious little in law. He may do, or from his own pocket, he may do something, but not when you're holding a position of trust as a judge does.
Deshinganimba, sir, the point you made about useless formality or empty formality, I mean, if it's of no consequence, should we think something more when it is demonstrated that even if you send it back or if it is to be again reverted back to any authority, nothing is going to happen other than whatever be the relief that we intend to give?
Correct.
Should we send it back?
No, you don't need to send it back. But what effectively you're not sending it back, you're actually dismissing the writ petition because you don't see a way forward.
Correct. So that will be one of the grounds for relief, denying relief.
Denying relief,
yes.
Justice Nambiar referred to Whirlpool Industries as well as Calcutta Discount Company.
Yes.
All these are referred to by Justice Appunayar in RTA, Paulos versus RTA Palghat.
That's right.
You must have appeared, Palghat.
Sir, we have CR Shivakumar raising the hand. Shivakumar, you got a question? Please put that. Unmute yourself, please. Shivakumar, can you hear me? Okay, fine. We have Radhakrishna Murthy raising the hand. Radhakrishna Murthy, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Loud and clear.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Actually, we have seen a number of judgments also says that these public remedies are discretionary and all. But as far as other view and all, and what is your view, sir?
I think what I was advocating was that there should be clear rules on the basis of which the judicial review court will say that we will not grant relief. It can't be just at the whims and fancies of the individual decision maker. One of those grounds which we have noticed, we have looked at, it is not that those grounds are exhaustive, but there may be new grounds which may crop up in later jurisprudence. But then these are generally the grounds on which I think if those grounds exist, I think we must refuse relief. Otherwise, just because I feel like I should not grant relief, the judge should not refuse relief. I think that's the thought that we have for the day.
Oh, because once the law is settled and all, based on that, definitely that will be binding on the single judge division bench, whatever, if it is a constitutional bench, say, of Supreme Court. Decide something and all. Tomorrow, on the very similar point, once if we approach the High Court, then this being a public, remedies and all, can the court say, no, because we have a discretionary power and all, therefore we can't grant.
No, look at it this way, sir.
According to my view and all, that can't be the discretionary and all, because definitely there it is a binding nature, isn't it?
No, see, look at it this way. Take the case of that employee who is overweight. His regulations require him to be below a certain weight. Now, it is settled law that you can't dismiss an employee, a government employee, without holding an inquiry.
Yes.
But take a situation where it is completely out of question to send it back because the authority cannot determine the issue in any other manner, even if the inquiry were to be held. Now, notwithstanding the binding law laid down by the Supreme Court that an inquiry must precede an action for dismissal, what would be, I think that still the courts would retain a discretion to say that because it is admitted facts show that no relief can be granted to him even if it is sent for inquiry. There's nothing to be proved. In such cases, I think still the courts will retain some discretion to refuse relief.
No, it's all right. It is not that key. In all cases, it will be only a discretionary and all. That's what I'm trying to say. Wherever in certain areas and all, definitely there will be a binding nature.
Certainly, certainly. If there is a binding judgment, it has to be followed. There's no doubt about it.
So that's the reason, I mean, all the public remedies, whatever available and all, it can't be the discretionary. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yes, you're right.
Okay, thank you.
Now, on the question of audio alteram partem, what is the position now? Whether supposing you were to be heard again, no useful purpose will be served, or do the courts still strike down the order?
Sir, I think it is settled that there is no technical violation of natural justice. But then faced with such a situation, we use the Megari J and John versus Reese. I think he says that anyone who has anything to do with the law knows that the path of law is strewn with examples of open and shut cases, which by discussion suffered a change. We can use that and send it back.
That is another form of discretion.
Yes. Say that I mean, very beautiful words used by him in that John versus Reese. I think it is it is extracted in that Express newspaper's case.
Yes.
We have Advocate David with a statement. David, would you like to come forward and put the question or? E. David.
Missing. Absconding.
Absolutely. Okay. Prem, who are you?
Yeah. What am I supposed to say? I would say it was absolutely spot on. That 45 minutes, we were all impressed by the crispness of your lordship's impeccable extempore. Right. And of course, the choice of topic, structuring the content, clarity of articulation, everything, it was fabulous. And of course, very relevant for the legal fraternity as well.
Thank you, Prince.
Thank you so much. And let me just add something. Normally, in writ jurisdiction, it is based on the concept of ex debitu justitia, right?
Yes.
Any jurisdiction, not only writ.
No. I'm asking only about the writ jurisdiction now. Now, as we have heard by His Lordship Justice Dama Seshadri Naidu, when he was speaking a couple of days back, the word itself, that Latin word suggests as a matter of right, which is opposed to as of grace. So if the jurisdiction itself is one which is based as a matter of right, can it be at once be a writ of grace or a writ of right? That doubt lingers, because if it is ex debitu justitia, it means as of right. And the Supreme Court also had the occasion to deal with what is ex debitu justitia. Of course, it was while considering Order 12, Rule 6, admission based judgment. Judgment based on admission. There were two rulings. And even Rupa Ashokpura also, I think, this particular principle, it was recognized as a recognition of debt, which is due from the justice delivery system. That be so, normally isn't the rule that it is as a matter of right instead as a matter of grace. Of course, the court holds the discretion. I'm not saying that the court does not have the discretion. Of course, even the Constitution of the Apex Court also holds. It is ultimately, it is a discretion. But still, ex debitu justitia as a term such as in its literary meaning, it says as a matter of right.
Prem, if I add something to that, could it not be much more certain than to the vagaries or the indecisiveness or indefiniteness? Could it not be specific because it's as of right?
So I am I'm just asking because at the end of the day, it's the discretion of the court. And of course, we have multitudes of rulings which pour in. What is discretion? It should be judicial, not capricious, not arbitrary. Of course, we have rulings like that, but still.
But what about supposing the same facts are placed before five judges? What would be their decision ultimately? Same facts.
I think, Prem, if I can just...
Yes, yes, Lordship. Definitely.
If you look at it from a philosophical point of view, for example, legal philosophy, when you're talking about ex-debitu justitiae, you're right that the question is whether it is granted as of right. But that's begging the question because we're asking the same question. Where is your right? And in most cases, people don't have an answer to that. And you know that since you're into using maxims, ubi ius in ibi remedium is also a maxim that you use. And you have a remedy only if you have a right. Now, whether we like it or not, we have forced upon ourselves or we have invited for ourselves a jurisprudence which is entirely right-based. And this came from the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence that we inherited. Ancient Indian law is premised primarily on the concept of duty and not on right. So we have, in our ancient scriptures, we have dharma as informing our legal system. It is not rights-based, it is duty-based. I have my own views on the damage that a rights-based system has done to our society in general because I feel that we've become more and more selfish as the law develops because everybody is asking the question as to what he or she can get from society, not what he or she can do for society. So since we are in a rights-based legal system, ex debitu justitiae necessitates that you establish that right for you to get the remedy. And you find that most people come to court thinking that they do have a right, but they can't trace their right to any particular source. And so I think that is primarily why you will not, there seems to be an aberration that you come to court as of right, but then somebody is exercising discretion. The discretion is exercised only to find that there is no right. And therefore there's no necessity to exercise discretion.
So in case of person is having the right, complete right.
Then what Gobi explains is the
correct
rule. Because correct. Even if you have the right, and you may well be entitled to the benefit of the law, but when it comes to giving you the remedy, it may be an exercise in futility because you will not be able to get what you ultimately need through recourse to the law. Like the policeman's case, he said. So, tricky issue there.
The problem is with judges varying on even on the existence of right. Different judges giving different verdicts.
Correct.
And at the higher hierarchical level also.
No, in fact, that is...
How come an acquittal becomes a conviction? A conviction becomes an acquittal. Whether in civil or criminal.
That is simultaneously good and bad because it is good because you have... You're not stuck with one opinion as binding everybody. And I'm sure everybody in this room will agree that you always need a person with another point of view because that may be more aligned to your point of view. So, and we all know, the lawyers also know that, a particular writ before a particular judge may be good, otherwise it may be bad. And, yes. Choose the judges accordingly if he had the choice. But... it is also something that is a hallmark of our system because if you have a judge who decides against you at the first level, you can always go and appeal and maybe you find two judges who will take the alternate view. And at the end of the day, you have to realize that it's like Dworkin said, Ronald Dworkin said, when a judge decides a case, he is deciding not because he thinks that there are two views and this is better. He decides because he thinks the view that he is taking is the only view possible. And it may be a subjective feeling, but...
That always happens. That subjective element always prevails.
It's always there. You can't...
But sir, at the same time, our constitutional courts, they being the sentinels of the people's right, they should not close their eyes to the matters which strictly do not fall within the realm of law. Maybe law is thrown to winds then, because the constitutional courts shut their eyes and the laws are thrown to the winds. Ultimately, it is the people who suffer.
No, Prev, I think I am very raw as a judge. There are many more experienced people here. Justice Chidambaram, Justice Ram Kumar, and Jayashankar. But what I felt is, ultimately, when you sit on that chair, what governs is equity. That's the feeling that I have got, because ultimately it is justice. You are where you want to grant relief, looking at justice. You always end up granting relief if you feel. Ultimately, that, or as somebody said, there is a binding precedent against. Those are difficult cases, but ultimately, I think sitting on the chair, you ultimately look at what is equitable. At least that's the feeling that I have had with the short days that I have been sitting. I would like. I think Justice Ram Kumar wants to say something on that.
No, during COVID-19 days, our hands are cleaner. For equity.
Correct.
For getting equitable relief.
No, but sir, I what I said is, the feeling that you get when a brief is put before, when a case bundle is put before you, is you look at, ultimately I think you're looking at ensuring that justice is done.
Whether the petitioner is guilty of suppression, whether he is guilty of uttering
all those things will definitely weigh
with the court.
Ultimately, I think somebody had an interesting reason as to why judges of superior courts are called justices and the others are called judges. I think the superior courts are expected to deliver justice and not just the law.
Right. But sir, again the question is, on one side, suppose in the case, on one side you are having a set of binding precedents, maybe constitutional decision, ever so many decisions are with the party which favors him. On the other side, if you apply that particular set of decisions to the facts of that particular case, of course that has to be applied, it will do injustice. But still, when the Supreme Court judgment, they have the law of the land, it has to be...
Those are the cases where I think judges often, I think, struggle, because even if they feel that they are bound to do something, if they are bound by precedent to do something else, yes. the discipline or whatever they call it,
judges have the art of surmounting a precedent.
Correct.
Inappropriate.
Normally, just yes, sir.
There's another point in this. See, I think over the years, our polity, our citizenry has been fed on this rhetoric that, you know, the ultimate solution for all their problems in law can be met through the judiciary. And this has catapulted this judiciary into some, you know, everybody in the judiciary seems to be suffering from some kind of a megalomania that we are the saviors, we are the messiahs. No. If you look at what is our function under the Constitution, whether be it the subordinate courts or whether the High Court or even the Supreme Court, you are supposed to apply the law to facts and render justice in accordance with law. It is not justice dehorse the law. We don't have the power to give justice dehorse the law. So you have to have justice in accordance with the law. Now, what happens in a situation like you pointed out, where there is a load of precedents that are against a particular client and his case and his cause, and you have and you know that in this particular case, if you apply those precedents, this man is going to suffer. Now you have to ask yourself whether he is suffering because the precedents have not been interpreted in a particular way to his facts, in which case, as Justice Ram Kumar was highlighting, you always can distinguish on facts the applicability of a judgment and render justice in this case. But if the facts are such and the law to such facts is also established through precedence, then whether you like it or not, that is the law of the land. And then you can't say that, you know, in your particular client's case, it is causing an injustice. Injustice is what you perceive because of a situation. But is it illegal? Answer is no, because that is in accordance with the law. In which case, the attempt must then be to change the law. And the changing of the law happens through the legislature. Because in all these discussions that we are having, we're conveniently forgetting that under our constitution, the judiciary was never to have the supremacy. It was always, right from its inception, if you look at the draft constituent assembly debates, right from the beginning, the emphasis or the focus has always been on a supremacy of the parliament, the legislative body, not the judiciary. Right. And it is this that has been slowly eroded over the years through judicial interpretation. And we have somehow managed to wrest to ourselves a power which is like beyond anything now. And I, as a student of constitutional law, if you ask me, is this desirable? Our answer is no. Because we cannot arrogate to ourselves such huge powers and that too in a written constitution. I mean, even Britain has not done this, although they don't have a written constitution. In a written constitution where there is a separation of powers, there is a principle of checks and balances, no organ is higher than the other. No limb of the governance is higher than the other. But yet, in our constitution, the drafters, the makers of the constitution wanted the legislative body to be the superior one. Of course, subject to the checks and balances that is imposed on it. And curiously, now today, we've reached a stage where sadly, neither the executive acts nor the legislature acts. And everybody is happy with the situation and they say, ultimately, we have the judiciary. And then when you have decisions which are not coming in your way in favor because the judiciary can't think, you blame the judiciary as well. So where is this taking us as a citizenry? I mean, it's a road to damnation. And we can't be going headlong into that road. So we need to think and we need to rethink our respective positions under the constitution. Yes.
Correct, sir. Correct.
On the judicial side, we very often say the legislature needs wisdom. As law secretary, I have seen the legislature's wisdom. Less said the better.
Sir, that brings us to the end of the 45th session of Legal Empowerment through Interaction Lecture Series. Deliberations, thoughts that has now been thrown into all the participants would be thinking deeply whether it's subjective or objective justice should be, whether it's legislature which is inactive or there is overactivism on the part of the judiciary. These are all things that has to be deliberated in detail and thought of in detail. But at least we could spark those thoughts. I would say that we were deeply indebted that we could have a speaker like Justice Gopinath today. And the presence of Justice Ramkumar sir, Justice Chidambare sir, Justice Jayashankar Nambiar sir was there with us. And I mean, all the participants for the proactive participation and whatever thoughts that were evoked or whatever train of thoughts that was lit today, we hope and wish that this will take us further in our endeavor of legal discovery. Till we meet again tomorrow when we have Justice C.K. Abdul Rahim tomorrow, with Justice Dispensation Confronting Conflicts. Till then, take care.
And I was just formally congratulating Gopi for his excellent. He has covered a good lot of ground in that.
Good work.
Sir, I was in fact going to say that he did beat Chidambare sir in the way he was presented. Chidambare sir took 45 minutes, he took 44 minutes. 1 minute. Oh.
The audience was spellbound.
Spellbound, correctly.
Absolutely.